Hello friends, welcome to a new lecture today on ataxia. So what is ataxia? Ataxia is due to cerebellar disorders. This is the brain, this is the brainstem, this is the medulla, pons, medulla, and then spinal cord. So this is posteriorly we have cerebellum, okay, and this is the ventricle. So whenever there is some disorders in the cerebellum, that causes ataxia. So the problem is here. So this is the main area for problem resulting in ataxia. So what are we going to see here? Here cerebellum, it is the main center for balance, for balancing, for knowing position sense, everything is through cerebellum. So whenever there is cerebellar disorders, it can cause gait imbalances. He is not able to maintain his gait properly. It can cause visual blurring. Okay, it can cause visual blurring. It can cause hand incoordination. For example, if I have to take this part and instead of grabbing like this, I'm not able to grab here because I'm not able to coordinate the movement of my hand to catch the pen. So that movement is lost. So there can be hand incoordination. Hand incoordination can be there. And there can also be tremors. There can be tremors with movements. Those can be there. So all these are the main symptoms which we see in cerebellar disorders. So gait impairment is also seen in one more disease, which is labyrinthine disease. In our body, one cerebellum is the central nervous is a part of central nervous system which will maintain the balance. There is also one part which is peripherally located, that is labyrinthine system, that is the inner ear, which also maintains our balance. Okay, but here whenever there is a labyrinthine disease or the inner ear disease, that will have an important symptom, which is dizziness. So dizziness is not present in cerebellar disease. It is only present in labyrinthine diseases. Whereas the others, dizziness, lightheadedness, vertigo, all these are not present in cerebellar diseases. They are just present on labyrinthine disease. So in labyrinthine disease we have dizziness, whereas in normal ataxia, that is cerebellar disease, we do not have dizziness or vertigo. Not only dizziness, it can be vertigo also. So the causes of cerebellar diseases, the cerebellar diseases or ataxia causes can be divided into symmetric or asymmetric, number one. Okay, symmetric, it can be divided into acute, which occurs in hours to days, or it can be subacute, or it can be chronic. Okay, acute is it occurs within hours to days. So for example, if there is an acute viral infection, that can cause symmetric ataxia. Okay, if it's intoxication, for example, suddenly a person takes some drugs like lithium, phenytoin, barbiturates, these were taken in a higher quantity, higher amounts than required, or alcohol, in such cases there can be intoxication, and it's in such cases there can be injury to the cerebellum. So that is acute, that is one of the acute cause. And sometimes after the infection, that is post infection also, there can be some chance of ataxia. Okay, infection to the cerebellum. So that is post infectious syndrome, which is most common after varicella. So those are the acute causes of ataxia. There are some subacute causes of ataxia. Subacute causes, the problem occurs within days to weeks. For example, a person has some cancer or some disease. So as a result, he is using some chemotherapeutic drugs or hemotherapeutic drugs or some cytotoxic drugs. In such cases, these can lead to subacute, because on using those drugs for some days, though the repeated use, that causes damage to the cerebellum. And one of the subacute cause is Lyme's disease. So Lyme's disease can also cause subacute cerebellar disease. Okay, what are the chronic diseases? The most important chronic disease is paraneoplastic syndrome. In paraneoplastic syndrome, it can be lung cancer or breast cancer or ovarian cancer or Hodgkin's disease. In all these cases, there will be destruction of cerebellum because of antibodies production through paraneoplastic syndrome. So that is one of the causes of chronic ataxia. There is one more thing, that is asymmetric. Asymmetric is mostly focal. So in focal, even this can be due to infection. This can be due to neoplastic changes. For example, if there is a glioma at some region, cerebellar glioma, only a particular part is disease is only in a particular part. That is, the disease is focal. As a result, the symptoms will also be focal. Okay. If there is some congenital lesions also, even they can result in focal or asymmetric cerebellar ataxia or cerebellar disease. So this ataxia can be of two types. It can be inherited, that is from the parents, or it can be acquired. If it is inherited, it can be autosomal dominant or autosomal recessive. There are many causes of autosomal dominant ataxia. They are called as spinocerebellar ataxia. Spinocerebellar ataxia. The ataxias which are inherited, that too through autosomal dominant inheritance, those are called as spinocerebellar ataxia. So there are many types of spinocerebellar ataxia. I'm not interested in discussing each of them, but the main causative thing in the I would like to discuss the pathophysiology of spinocerebellar ataxia so that we will understand it in a better way. In pathophysiology, spinocerebellar ataxia, here it is mainly due to genetic, right? That too I have said, it's autosomal dominant. So there is genetically, there is a defect, that is, there is expanded CAG triplet repeats. Expanded CAG triplet repeats. Normally, this CAG codes for glutamate. So, because there is expanded triplet CPT, triplet repeats, CAG repeats, so there is a large amount of polyglutamate, increased glutamate. So, because of increased glutamate, this will lead to a protein, production of protein, which is called as ataxin. This ataxin, it is accumulated either in the cytoplasm of the nucleus or in the nucleus of nuclei of neuron. So it can be accumulated either in the cytoplasm or in the nucleus or in the nucleoli. So whether it is accumulated in neuron or in the cytoplasm or nuclei, based on that, it is divided into different types of spinocerebellar ataxia. So what does this do? So this ataxin, it will bind to other proteins, and thus after binding to other proteins, it will alter ubiquitin proteasome system. Ubiquitin proteasome system, and thus it causes apoptosis of neuron. Okay, it gets accumulated in these areas, and this will attach to other proteins, and this will alter ubiquitin proteasome system, thus causing apoptosis. So the main signs and symptoms are similar to the cerebellar disease, like impairment in gait impairment, equilibrium impairment, slow movements, hand incoordination. There can be eye visual defects. There can be some tremors. So all those can be there. So spinocerebellar ataxia, it is divided into many types. 1, 2, and then 3, 4, like that. There are 13 types of spinocerebellar ataxia, 16 types of spinocerebellar ataxia. I'm not interested in discussing about them, each and every type. Okay. Then, this is about autosomal dominant ataxia. Now, there is one more ataxia which I have said, which is autosomal recessive because of inherited. So, the most common example of autosomal recessive inherited ataxia is Frederick's ataxia. This Frederick's ataxia, it is more common and it is due to the deficiency of vitamin D. It is associated with deficiency of vitamin D. Obviously, it is genetic and it is autosomal recessive inheritance, but most commonly seen in vitamin D deficiency. Let me just tell you the pathophysiology of Frederick's ataxia. In Frederick's ataxia, there is expanded GAA triplet repeats. So, because there is expanded GAA triplet repeats, this will lead to the production of frataxin gene. So, frataxin gene will produce a protein which is called as frataxin protein. So, this frataxin protein decreases iron transporter or iron transportation, and as a result, iron is accumulated in the cell. This iron which is accumulated in the cell, this will cause cell injury. So, this is about Frederick's ataxia. Okay. So, this in turn causes neuronal injury. At the end, all the types of ataxia, this should cause neuronal injury in one way or other. So, this Frederick's ataxia, it is mainly of two types. One, it can be due to beta lipoproteinemia, or the other, it can be due to ataxia with vitamin E deficiency. So, what are the clinical features that you see? You see all the neurological features. You can see nystagmus, you can see, you know, dysarthria first. And then you can also see dysmetria, that is difficulty in assessing the distance. There is blurring of vision. There is difficulty in maintaining posture. There can be tremors. There can be loss of position sense. There can be loss of vibratory sense. All those can be there. Then sometimes you can also see cardiovascular involvement in Frederick's ataxia. Cardiovascular involvement can occur in cardiomegaly, can be there, or there can be murmurs. Okay. So these are the different features which we see in Frederick's ataxia, which is an autosomal recessive ataxia. Now, what are you going to see on MRI? On MRI, you can see atrophy of cerebellum. Because there is a problem in the cerebellum and there is destruction of neurons of cerebellum, the most common MRI finding which you see in any type of ataxia is cerebellar atrophy. So these two are the most important types of ataxia. I just thought of giving you a brief introduction about ataxia, and when I get time, I'll take a brief clear lecture on ataxia, each type of ataxia. So right now, thank you guys for watching my lecture. If you have any doubts, please comment it in the comment section. If you feel something is inadequate in this lecture, even then comment it in the comment section. Thank you for watching my lecture. Thank you.